Listening Library presents The Swifts, A Dictionary of Scoundrels, by Beth Lincoln. Read for you by Nikki Patel.
Foreword, written and read by me, Beth Lincoln. Dull, adjective. Not exhilarating, not delightful, as to make dictionaries is dull work. Samuel Johnson, entry in A Dictionary of the English Language, 1755. I've included this definition as a warning. This is a note about language, the differences between American and British English, and the changes that have been made for the American edition of this book. If this sounds unbearably dull to you, you're welcome to skip ahead and join Shenanigan at the funeral. The English language is big, messy, and argumentative. Languages are alive, and they're voracious, which means they'll grab whatever words are lying around and swallow them whole. The lands that now make up the British Isles were invaded and settled repeatedly through their early history, so lots of different languages went down the English gullet. Scraps of old Saxon and Gaelic, pieces of old Norse from the Vikings, a great chunk of Latin from the Romans, and a healthy dollop of French from the Norman conquest. English fed and grew from its earliest form as Old English, around 450 CE to 1100 CE, to the lanky Middle English, 1100 to 1500 CE, and only really became recognisable to the modern speaker from 1500 CE on during the early modern period. In fact, if you went back in time to before 1500-ish and asked a passing villager what day it was, it is unlikely you would understand each other, which is just one of the many reasons to avoid time travel. The result of all this is that although the words hypnosis, flux, and berserk are all technically English words, they can be traced back to totally different root languages. This history of words is called etymology, and it's a fascinating subject, if you're me. Unfortunately, the 1500s was also when England turned around and began its centuries-long project of invading everywhere else. It began with its neighbours in Wales, Scotland, and Ireland, and from there the United Kingdom oversaw centuries of bloody colonisation overseas. While it was robbing other countries of their wealth and liberty, it also looted many languages for useful words. This is how we got words like pyjama, barbecue, and trek, for example, and I encourage you to look up their origins. At the same time, people across the globe were forced to learn English, the language of the empire. By the year 1900, the British Empire believed itself to own a third of the world. It had colonies on the continents of North America and Africa, in the islands of the Caribbean, and in the regions of South Asia and the Middle East. Many of these larger British colonies were far from England and occupied territory alongside other imperial powers like the French, the Spanish, and the Dutch. Consequently, these territories developed their own branching forms of English, which is why American, Canadian, Australian, and South African English all look and sound slightly different from each other. The Swifts are British, but because the book you're about to listen to is the American edition, we've made a few changes with this in mind. You might already know that the British call chips crisps and fries chips, and many of those words remain, but we've switched out a few to something more familiar. We've also spelled things the American way. Before the invention of the dictionary, there was no such thing as correct spelling. So long as you could be understood, you could spell words however you liked. In fact, I could write the word bureaucracy or mischievous three different ways in the same sentence and it would still be perfectly acceptable. It wasn't until Johnson's A Dictionary of the English Language that English speakers had a shared point of reference and could begin to agree on the right way to spell things. A few years after Johnson and a couple of thousand miles west, Noah Webster saw that the American classrooms were still using a hodgepodge of textbooks and reading materials left over from British rule. He decided to make a truly American guide to the English spoken in his country. Webster asked a lot of questions about British English. Why is there an unnecessary U in the word humour? Why is pretense not spelled with an S when that's the way it sounds, or analyse spelled with a Z? Why isn't soup spelled S-O-O-P? Admittedly, that last one didn't stick, but many of his changes did. In 1783, Webster published the first edition of A Grammatical Institute of the English Language, which became known as the Blue-Backed Speller because of the colour, and that's colour without the British U, mind, of its cover. It was used in American classrooms for generations, and nowadays, Webster is still the biggest name in American dictionaries. Speaking of which, though we've largely followed Webster's guidance, we've left the Swifts' names alone. The Swifts are British, and so is the dictionary that named them. Names don't follow the same rules as other words and shouldn't be changed without the permission of the owner. This means that Endeavour Swift would keep her extra British U for the same reason we wouldn't remove the accented E from Inez or change the Irish Gaelic spelling of Rory. It's important to note that neither British nor American English is the correct one, and in fact, there's no proper way to speak, or write, or spell. The thing about language is that it can't stay still. Restless and impatient, it races forward without waiting for our dictionaries to catch up. The changes made in this book are meant to make it easier for us to understand each other. It's the entire point of having language in the first place. In fact, I would say that if a person is rude about the way you speak, write, or spell, then they are showing a distinct lack of understanding, and it's perfectly reasonable to make up a creative word to describe them.
Part 1. Chapter 1. An Unexpected Inheritance. It was a bright, well-dressed morning in early May, and the Swifts were in the middle of a funeral. The house looked very fine. The lawns had been swept clean of leaves, the hedge maze had been trimmed, and the statues had been scrubbed behind the ears. The family had spent the morning practicing their eulogies in front of a mirror, and now they walked in slow procession through the cemetery, faces professionally grim. According to Arch Aunt Schadenfreude, a funeral ought to look like a wedding upside down. The Swifts had done their best to honour her wishes. The path to Aunt Schadenfreude's grave frothed with flowers, and the trees dripped black ribbon. Cook had even baked a sombre cake with black icing, set on a table just to the left of the headstone. To the right, a gramophone coughed out a melancholy tune. Shenanigan Swift was carrying the front end of the coffin. She was considerably shorter than the other pallbearers. At the back, her eldest sister Felicity gangled, and her uncle Maelstrom loomed, and although Shenanigan was doing her best to keep the coffin steady, it still tilted forward at a worrying angle. Phenomena, ahead of the procession and guiding her sisters through the cemetery like an air traffic controller, shot her a wary look. Shenanigan tried to think herself taller, with limited success. They wound between the graves like black floss through crooked teeth. Shenanigan read the names of her late family as they trudged past. Calamitous Swift, 1598 to 1652. Adjective, causing or fraught with disaster. And Godwatery Swift, 1733 to 1790. Noun. 1. Overly elaborate gardening or garden design. 2. Old-fashioned and affected language. She shifted the weight of the coffin, and it lurched alarmingly. Felicity hissed, so Shenanigan wobbled it again, just to annoy her. Her hand left a smear on the expensive, highly polished wood. Her aunt wouldn't have liked that. Aunt Schadenfreude believed you should spend more on a coffin than you would on a house, since you spent more time dead than alive. But then Aunt Schadenfreude wouldn't have liked a lot of things, like the scuffs on Shenanigan's shoes, or the twigs in her hair, or the thoughts in her head. To her right, Shenanigan read, Faultress Swift, 1860 to 1889. Noun. A female offender or criminal. Shenanigan probably would have got on with her. They halted before the grave, and there was a flurry of confusion as each Swift lowered the coffin at a different speed. Maelstrom tried to set his end down slowly, with dignity, but Felicity was a bit too fast, and Shenanigan was still thinking about being a faultress and not paying attention.
Shenanigan! Felicity hissed again. Can you please?
The thing inside the coffin let out a yowl. Felicity cried out and dropped her side. With a dull thunk, the head end of the coffin hit the grass, teetered, and tipped over into the grave, the lid flying off as it went. Shenanigan leapt out of its path and straight into the black frosted cake, her outstretched palms scooping up damp, vanilla-scented handfuls. There was silence, but for the gramophone's wheeze. The Swifts peered cautiously into the grave. The coffin lay wide open, revealing a gleam of black silk warming in the sun. Of course, there was no one in it, Only John the cat, who blinked sleepily, gave a luxuriant stretch and trotted off in the direction of the woods. Shenanigan licked cake off her hands.
Well, called a voice behind them. That was an appalling rehearsal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.